Hello, everyone. Welcome to the Demystifying Medicine podcast, Measles Virus Edition. We are lucky to have an expert here on the field today to help us break down the measles virus. Welcome, Dr. Caitlyn Mullarkey. Thank you for taking the time to speak with us today. Would you like to introduce yourself quickly for our audience?
Sure. Excellent. Yes, I'm happy to be here. Thank you for the invitation. My name is Caitlyn Mullarkey. I am a faculty member in biochemistry and biomedical sciences at McMaster University. I am a viral immunologist by training, so I've spent a long time thinking about viruses and the immune system, and with a particular emphasis on how to build better influenza virus vaccines.
Wonderful. Thanks for joining us again, Dr. Mullarkey, and for agreeing to appear on our podcast. If you don't mind, we're just going to jump right in and ask you a few questions about the measles virus.
Sure.
So let's start off with the basic question to get our foundations in order. Can you give us a general overview of what measles is?
Sure. So measles virus belongs to a family of viruses that are known as paramyxoviruses. So these are viruses that have negative single-stranded RNA genomes. And measles virus in particular is an envelope virus, which means that in addition to the nucleic acid, which is a genome, it's surrounded by a bit of protein, and that bit of protein is surrounded by a lipid. And this is what we mean by envelope viruses. Now, embedded within that lipid envelope are two surface proteins. They're known as hemagglutinin, which is often abbreviated H. And there's a fusion protein, which is often abbreviated F. And the hemagglutinin and the fusion proteins that are on the surface of the virus are responsible for attachment and entry. So this is how measles virus actually binds to host cell receptors and gets into the cell in order to replicate.
Well, thank you for that. Just a little follow-up question. So measles is kind of seen as a virus of the past in many lights, yet it's mm-hmm. super important today. Could you touch on what makes measles relevant today?
Sure. So just to kind of begin at the beginning. So measles virus causes the infection, which we commonly know as measles. So it gets a little confusing there, right? When we're talking about the virus or the infection, which is the manifestation of the virus once it enters into the body. So what's really important to put this whole conversation into context is really how contagious measles is. Measles is the most contagious virus that we know of. And when we talk about contagiousness, there's a term that epidemiologists use, and it's been batted around with the SARS-CoV-2 pandemic, which is the basic reproduction number, which is often abbreviated as R0. So the basic reproduction number is the number of individuals that will go on to be infected from one infected individual. Okay, so if I myself am infected and there aren't any interventions, this assumes that there aren't any interventions, so no vaccination, no drugs, no masking or social distancing. One infected individual with measles will go on to infect somewhere between 12 to 18 other individuals. Okay, so there's a little bit of range. Sometimes we estimate it and say the basic reproduction number for measles is 15. And that's huge, right? If you think about if one person goes on to infect 15 people and those 15 people go on to infect 15 more people, you can see that the capacity to transmit, it amplifies very, very quickly. And for comparison, right, we're all still living in a SARS-CoV-2 pandemic. The basic reproduction number for SARS-CoV-2 is between 2 and 3, are our best estimates, right? So it's 7 times more contagious than SARS-CoV-2, which I think many of us already feel is quite ubiquitous. And so measles, we have a vaccine for measles that was introduced in 1963. Before 1963, pretty much everyone got measles. So most individuals before the age of 15 would have been infected with measles. So there were hundreds of millions of cases a year. We've seen a drastic decline since the introduction of the vaccine in 1963, and I'm sure we'll get on to the vaccine. The vaccine is very highly efficacious, safe and efficacious. So we currently, there are less measles cases than there were decades ago, but we still have millions of cases somewhere between, there's probably tens of millions of cases of measles globally every year. Those are enriched in developing countries in Africa and Asia, there are hundreds of thousands of deaths globally per year from measles. And I think what we've learned, again, to go back to this living in a pandemic, is that in the age of globalization, with travel and trade, viruses spread very quickly. So even if virus circulating in other places, it threatens the whole global population.
Right. And that leads nicely into my next question. How does measles spread from person to person?
Right. Yes. So measles, when people think of measles, the disease, they'll think of the stereotypical rash, right? So it causes a rash that has red flat spots and then bumps that come out of what's called a maculopapular erythematous rash. So you have bumps, but you have these red flat spots as well, and it's full body. And this is the classic kind of diagnostic feature of measles, is this full body rash. So you might think that contact with the rash or contact with the skin is how measles transmits, and it's not. It's actually transmitted via respiratory droplets. Measles is transmitted from coughing and sneezing and breathing, which releases these small droplets into the air. And then individuals who come in contact with those droplets or in close contact with nasal secretions or throat secretions, that's how they are exposed to the virus. So not unlike, again, what we've been hearing a lot about respiratory viruses with SARS-CoV-2, which is transmitted in a similar way.
Great. So you mentioned one of the characteristic symptoms was the rash. Could you expand on that symptom as well as some of the other symptoms typical of measles?
Right. So with measles, so one interesting fact about measles is that it has a relatively long incubation period. And what I mean by incubation period is the time between when you're exposed to the time when you first develop symptoms. So it's around 10 to 12 days. So if someone sneezes on you and you're exposed, you won't actually develop any symptoms that alert you to the fact that you're ill or you're infected until 10 to 12 days later. So some of the first symptoms for measles, like many other viruses, fever, runny nose, cough, and then a few days after the initial onset of symptoms, oftentimes you can observe in the mucosa in the inside of your mouth are what are known as coplic spots. So these are areas where the virus is replicating, and you can see these small white spots on the inside of an infected individual's mouth. And then the rash appears, the very classic rash appears somewhere 3 to 5 days after the initial onset of symptoms. So the initial onset will be the generalized fever, cough, runny nose, and then these other more characteristic or even diagnostic features of measles appear later. And unfortunately, you are contagious before you show the rash, right? So most you can transmit to other individuals before you even know that you're infected with measles, which again, I think it demonstrates then how rapidly this particular virus can spread, because if you don't feel ill enough to stay home, you might be going out to the supermarket or to a sporting event or, you know, the mall and transmit to other individuals.
Wow, that's so scary, but so fascinating at the same time. So you mentioned that they spread from one spot and then eventually spreads throughout the body. And we were wondering, what's the mechanism behind that?
Measles has a really interesting pathogenesis. So I've already told you that it's transmitted via respiratory secretions. So it typically enters the body in the upper respiratory tract, and it actually infects immune cells. So often, it also affects the respiratory epithelium, but that happens later in the infection. The first cells it's going to infect are immune cells. And immune cells traffic in your body through the lymphatic system, and then the lymphatic system crosses over into your blood. So essentially, the virus is able to breach many inherent layers of defense that we have anatomically, to gain access into the blood. And then once it's in the blood, obviously it can disseminate everywhere. And so what happens is once it gains access to the blood, it has access to things like your skin. And then when the virus gets access to the skin and replicates in the skin, that's what causes the rash. It can also gain access to the brain. So encephalitis is a severe adverse outcome from a measles virus infection. So that happens in probably about, pre-vaccine, it would happen in about 1 in 1,000 individuals who are infected with measles. So once it gains access into your bloodstream, it can then actually also basically traffic back to the respiratory epithelium, which it then infects through the bottom. Okay, this is what's very counterintuitive about measles, is the receptor for entry into the virus is located on what we call the basolateral surface of respiratory epithelial cells, which means it's not the side that faces out, which you would anticipate, like the side that faces out into the lumen of the respiratory tract. It faces the inside. So it infects from the bottom and then is released through the apical side or the outside. And then that's how someone transmits it again. So it's complex and unusual in that way. Most viruses would infect in the complete opposite way. They would enter the apical surface.
Thank you. That was really in depth and very interesting. So you kind of talked a bit about the vaccine already. But I wanted to know, obviously, a bit more about the vaccine and some pre-existing interventions, as well as any existing interventions to stop measles once you are infected. You think you could talk a bit about that?
Sure. So I guess we'll start with the vaccine. Again, we've had a vaccine since 1963. It is highly, highly efficacious. So 2 shots of the measles vaccine will protect 97% of individuals for their entire lifetime. So it elicits lifelong protection in the vast, vast, vast majority of individuals who receive it. Obviously, no vaccine is perfect. No vaccine is 100%. But measles is really up there in terms of efficaciousness. I think probably maybe the yellow fever vaccine has a slightly higher efficacy rate. But we have a very good and safe vaccine. Currently, the measles vaccine is given in combination with the mumps and rubella vaccine. So it's given all together as one shot that's known as the MMR, which probably has some name recognition. So we have a highly efficacious preventative mechanism for measles. If you were to become infected with measles, either because you're one of those 3% of individuals who didn't respond well to the vaccine or had suboptimal protection, or if you're unvaccinated, you didn't take up the vaccine, there really aren't any interventions beyond supportive care to treat measles. So things like hydration, managing the fever with, you know, appropriate, usually NSAIDs, appropriate drugs for fever management. There aren't any licensed antivirals for measles. So once you're infected, really the only treatment is supportive care.
Hey, thank you. So vaccinations are highly important for the measles disease.
Yes. Right. So if we talk about it, so this really brings us to an important point, which is global vaccine access. So, and again, as we're seeing in real time, even if certain areas have vaccine uptake nationally, there may be pockets where there's lower vaccine uptake. So there's communities that may be susceptible to outbreaks because locally the vaccine uptake isn't high. But again, there's large regions of the world that don't have access to vaccines or can't afford vaccines. And so measles continues to be a big problem in developing countries. And in particular, in light of the SARS-CoV-2 pandemic, dozens and dozens and dozens of countries have delayed vaccination campaigns for measles. So this is something that has the potential really to have a knock-on consequence in the upcoming years, right? We've affected the vaccine uptake rate. So it's possible we could see resurgences of measles in higher numbers than we've seen previously. I mean, it will be interesting to see that, because obviously what we have now, we have social distancing and masking measures in place. those might not be in place forever and might not be observed in places. So that might mitigate it to some extent, but it is something that is of global concern. And measles is also what I'll point out, individuals that are most susceptible to severe outcomes with measles are young unvaccinated children. So the measles vaccine isn't usually given until a year, right? So there for a year, there is a large cohort of the global population that aren't even eligible for vaccination. And then if we talk about access to vaccine, you can, that number is compounded. So when we talk about consequences of measles virus infection, most severe in younger children, where it can lead, I told you that it infects immune cells, right? That's one of the target cells. So as a consequence of measles infection, you are transiently immunosuppressed, and that leaves you vulnerable to secondary bacterial infections. So for a period after measles virus infections, you're more susceptible to other infections. And this is actually a leading cause of death in developing countries, is secondary bacterial infections. And again, measles, the estimates for death, right? Morbidity and mortality, when we talk about those measurements for measles, again, pre-vaccine, probably 1 in 1,000 infected individuals succumb to measles, but that number can actually, that number goes up to almost 30% if you talk about populations where there is malnourishment. So individuals, and again, in developing countries that might be undernourished, if they become infected with measles, are at a higher risk of death. Okay, so they're at a higher risk of death inherently from the first infection with measles, and then subsequently are also at a higher risk for developing secondary bacterial infection. There are long-term serious, what we call sequelae of measles, which are basically outcomes subsequent to infection, so after infection. So we think of measles as kind of an innocent childhood disease, but there are, people still die from measles. We can develop secondary bacterial infections because of that immunosuppression. And it's possible for, again, the virus to gain access into the brain and cause encephalitis, which is obviously very dangerous.
Thank you. That was really, really, really detailed. I really appreciate that. Really helped thank you so much for joining us today. That's all the questions we have for today. Yeah. Yes. If you have any more information or details you'd like to add on, or things you think you want to put in, just please send us information, and we can also upload this to our site and add it to a video.
For sure. Okay. Mm-hmm. Good to speak with you.
Thank you so much again for coming.
All right. Take care.
We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.